Number 62.
I am living now in Canaan. singing hallelujah,
where the meal
and honey flows.
I will sing it
o'er the land.
How that Jesus
sets me free. The soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. First and last verse of Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet a sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind,
made our lives miserable today. But you know what? God's children are His children.
Yes.
That's His ones He has fellowship with.
Yes.
And not to say that He don't love the sinner, because He loves the sinner just as much as He does His children.
Yeah.
He like to see them make things right with Him. And they just keep turning a deaf ear to Him. Amen. But we thank Him for the day He's blessed us with. Thank you, Mr. Levy, that's come out to support our revival. I want to welcome you into our church. Amen.
Yeah.
Do the best that we can just to preach the word of God and tell it like it is. Tell the truth about it. Not to water nothing down. Not to sugarcoat nothing.
Amen.
But to tell it exactly like it is. Amen. I know I told the Lord a long time ago that I'll preach it. I'll tell it just exactly like it is. Amen.
Amen.
Or I won't tell it at all. And a lot of people have got to the point with the preaching and with the teaching that they can't really accept the true word of God. They've gotten to the point that everything is okay anymore.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. The word of God ain't changed.
No, that's right.
It's the same today as it was 2,000 years ago. It's not changed any. Amen. And we have still got to abide by the words that God has given us if we want to enter into God's kingdom.
Amen.
Because there'll be no sin over there. I think about that from time to time, a place where God's children can gather together, amen, and don't have any interference with from Satan.
Amen.
No interference from Satan's children, amen.
Amen.
But just to get together in true fellowship with one mind one mind and one accord.
Amen.
And I know that one day that those things are going to take place, and God's children will be redeemed. And I wonder about it from time to time that how long will God allow His children to suffer the persecution that we suffer down here, amen, just to see somebody get saved. God giving them more time and more time and more time, amen. But the sad part of it is the more time that God gives, the farther this nation turns away from it.
Yeah, that's right.
The farther we go, the farther it gets away from the Word of God, amen. Yeah. But the Bible plainly prophesies and it tells us that these times are coming.
Yeah.
That these things are going to happen, amen. And we don't need to be alarmed. We don't need to find a cave and run into it, amen. But God told us.
Yeah.
He told us in His Word,
amen,
the things that was going to come to pass. And you and I have seen a lot of stuff come to pass that puts the church a little bit more, a little closer to that day of the rapture than the church has ever seen, amen. And the church ought to be on shouting ground tonight, amen, because we're a little bit closer. Amen. Well, we see things develop with our own eyes. Amen. Amen. That the Bible plainly talks about. We see it develop with our own eyes. Amen. Church, we're going home every while.
Amen.
We're going home every while.
Amen.
There's going to be a day, praise God, that the Father's going to tell the Son, it's time to bring them up.
Yeah.
It's time to give them out.
Right.
Amen. It's time for them to come home.
Yeah.
Amen.
Come on.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yes.
I remember doing weddings, and I stand up at the front of the church. Me and the groom, amen, will stand there. And then when that music starts on that piano, that the bride comes marching up the aisle, every head in the church will turn and look at that bride. Praise God. Let me tell you something, church. We are the bride.
Yeah.
We are the bride, amen. And we'll walk down those streets of glory.
Yeah.
Praise God. Those heavenly beings, they'll all stand as the bride comes in.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Amen, bro.
They'll stand as the bride comes in. Yeah. That bride, praise God, is the church.
Yes.
Amen.
It's the church.
That's
amen.
Right, brother.
Amen. We'll get there.
That's good, brother.
We'll get there. Keep on keeping on.
Yeah.
Keep on keeping on for the Lord.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Amen, brother.
I didn't feel like none of this when I first come in. Amen. Just about ain't stopped all day. I worked all weekend. I've run all day long. A little tired. I ain't now. Anyway,
yeah,
come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest.
Yes.
That's what the Word of God says.
Yeah.
Hey, amen. I can't give you no rest. I can't give you much of nothing. I can take you home with me. I'll feed you a little bit. I can give you a dry place to lay down. But I can't give you rest. I can't give you rest. That rest has got to come from in here.
Yeah.
Hey, amen.
Amen. Bless
you. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls.
Yes.
Hey, amen.
That's it, brother.
My yoke is easy, and my burden is light.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. I laid down that old yoke of sin many years ago. Many years ago.
Yeah.
I was just a boy. Just a boy. I praise God that I laid that down before I got into a whole heap of trouble. Amen. I praise God that I don't look back on my childhood with a lot of regret, because I accepted the Lord as my Savior when I was a kid. Amen.
Amen.
And I know He steered me clear of a lot of stuff.
Yes.
A lot of stuff. And I praise Him.
Thank you. Amen.
We're going to come around the altar with prayer. I know we've all got prayer requests. I know we've all got loved ones. I don't know how y'all are, but there's times that I see the faces. There's times their names run before my eyes. There's times 12:30 at night, I wake up with them on my mind.
Yeah.
The Lord knows them. He knows all about them. I'll not judge no man. I'll not judge no woman. But God knows those hearts. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you something. People talk about this judging stuff. If you see somebody steal something and you call them a thief, that's not judging. That's telling like it is. That's not getting into the political correctness side of everything. Amen. Because you get in when it's politically correct, then the truth ain't revealed.
Right.
So that's not judging. Amen.
Amen.
But I praise God, the brother comes up wanting to hold a revival. Lord knows we need it. So glad y'all are here. Amen. Wonder if anybody has a request on your heart tonight before we come around to pray. Anything at all. Amen.
Most of all, I thank the Lord for saving me.
Yes.
I'd like for y'all to remember Sissy and remember Miss Anna Mullen. She's real sick. They said she might make it 2 days. So do remember her. Remember her family tonight.
Amen. That's bring the heart on family.
Amen. Let's remember the sinners.
Amen.
I've got a decision to really need to pray.
Me and Brother Fred did a revival little church. I think that's where we was at, where I was at when I made mention of this. I make mention of it again. And you know, this pertains to the whole church. It pertains to everybody. You know, you look in the mirror and you recognize who you're looking at. You recognize yourself. Amen. And if we took a group picture of everybody here, everybody stand, and we take a group picture, and we put that, blow it up, and we put it up here. Now, when that was done, maybe to you, years ago, as soon as you got that picture, you looked through and you found yourself, and you said, well, there I am. Well, that's me standing right here outside of so-and-so. This is me right here. But did you know in the Word of God that the same thing is going on with the Word of God? It's a group picture. And when the Word of God is being preached, are you willing to get up and say, that's me? Is that, that's me. Because if you don't, you're not only deceiving yourself. Because ain't none of us good. The church is made up of a bunch of low-life sinners. That's what makes up the church. That's what makes up the bride. And I'm about as low-life as anybody in here. Why? God save me. He saved me. So, through this revival, if it hits on your foot, hits on your toes, you don't have to run up to the front, but to yourself, recognize yourself. They say that's one of the ways that they determine an animal's intelligence, is if they put a mirror in front of it and it recognizes itself. A lot of them don't. A lot of people won't even. But if you see yourself, recognize yourself, and know that it is you.
Amen.
And I know that it is me. Amen. Anybody else got a request?
Brother Ricky, I'd like to say it's good to be back in the Lord's house tonight. Most of all, it's good to be saved.
Amen.
I can remember our lost tonight. We have children that's unsaved.
Amen.
Just pray for the lost everywhere. Always be with me. Always in a need of prayer.
Amen. Remember that. Anybody else?
Remember my husband tonight that he
can
save your voice today.
Well,
amen.
I want to tell y'all something about prayer. This has been my observation. It might not be your observation. It's been my observation many, many times. I had a convict one day. I was doing my security checks over at the prison and stopped and talked to him. And he asked me, he said, something about the Bible. He asked if I'd pray for him. I said, you won't try to kill me, will you? And he saw me a couple days ago, and he said, do you remember that? And I said, yeah. But I'm going to tell you folks something. When you begin to ring out those prayer bells of heaven, when you begin to call out people's names, when you begin to get earnest and get into that prayer and have a concern in your heart, and you begin to pray and to weep for that lost person,
yeah.
Do you think one second that Satan is going to allow you to do that because you're trying to call up one of his? He's not going to sit back and allow you to do that without some problems.
Yeah.
He will cause you problems, and the problems will come from that very one that you have built an altar for to pray for, or you've been fasting for to pray for. That's where the persecution will come from, that one person. Amen. Seen it so many times. So when you begin to pray for somebody and that person starts doing mean things to you, remember, your prayers are getting through.
Amen.
Prayers are getting through. Amen. Hey, anybody else?
Brother Rick, I thank the Lord for saving my soul.
Yeah.
I thank Him that we're able to get out of the church and remember us.
Amen. Anybody else?
I've got a very special and spoken request tonight. And everyone pray for it.
Amen.
Bless them.
We got oil up here too.
Anybody pray for Kevin?
I believe in it.
Amen.
Anybody?
Continue to remember our, my two sons, if you would, their loss, and pray for salvation. Like I said, I'm glad I'm saved. Good to be in church tonight, and appreciate my church family coming out. They've been praying for me for a long time. I appreciate the Lord. I know he's got a great movement to do here at this church, but then everybody here inside this church. I'm glad I'm saved. Glad to be here.
Praise the Lord. Brother, it's very good to have you. Very good to have y'all. More than we've ever explained to you with words. I do appreciate it. Anybody else?
I thank God for all he's done in my life and all that he's yet going to do. Yeah. I ask for y'all to keep my children in your prayers.
Yeah.
Especially my son. He was raised in church. He knows what's right. But he's got a little taste of this world. And he's battling inside, and I see that daily. But I just pray that I can show the love of the Lord.
Yes, everybody. Yes, Lord.
I remember a time when I went that lovable, but he loved me.
Yes.
God, thank you for loving me. When I went lovable. Pray for my family that's lost and undone. Pray for me that I'd ever be a vessel that my Lord can use.
Yeah, you know it.
It's all prayer, not one for another.
Yes.
You know, you may not know the problem that the person sitting right behind you or in front of you or somewhere in the church, you may not know what they're dealing with on a daily basis. Let me tell you something. Everybody in it is dealing with some problems. Mm-hmm. Every one of us are.
Yeah.
Y'all know that prayer is the most powerful force in the world.
Amen.
Hiroshima, Nagasaki, they've not seen anything yet. The prayers of God's children is the most powerful force in the universe. Nothing can beat it. Amen. Anybody else?
I want to thank the Lord for saving me. And you know what you said is true. You know, I cry out to the Lord every night for my children. And my youngest son cannot give me a good word. He cannot.
Amen.
So I pray that what I'm praying every night, crying out to the Lord for my boys, is ringing true.
Amen.
Because he can't. He just can't seem to give me a good word anymore.
Amen.
And I just hope the Lord just pours it on me. I hope he makes that bed too short.
Yeah.
That he can't get a night's rest.
Amen.
I hope he wrestles in covers to where he just can't sleep at all. That he'll just get on his knees and cry out to the Lord. I hope so.
Amen.
My oldest boy too. But I want the Lord to save them. There's nothing in this world I want any more than to see my boys and my grandchildren get on their knees and cry out to God. Even if it means taking my life, I'd gladly give my life to see my kids, grandkids and kids saved.
Amen.
No, I will.
I know where you're coming from on that.
There's nothing more I want to see than see that.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's
remember that request tonight. Amen. And I know exactly where you're coming from on that. At the times that they've actually tried to kill me. I mean, I'm talking about literally. They've tried it close to half a dozen times. Succeeded once. But you go to pray for people. It's going to cause some problems for you. Amen. Good thing. Anybody else got a request?
Brother Rick, we'd like to say tonight it's good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to be saved and have this crowd with us tonight. It's always time is running out. It certainly is. You know, we need to get concerned. And I guess more than we've ever been before, because we're living right down in this, I believe, in the Saturday evening of time. I believe that the Lord could come at any given moment. And, you know, it behooves us to be ready to meet the Lord. You know, I'm just thankful tonight that I know that I know that I know my name is recorded. Oh, that if my heart would stop beating right now. Thank God, I know that I've got a better place to go.
Yes, amen. Amen.
Started this journey 48 years ago, and amen, it just gets sweeter all the time. Thank God. And, but you know, each tick of the heartbeat, amen, we're just getting a little closer home.
Amen.
Yes, we are. Amen. That song we sang, I don't regret a mile that I've traveled for the Lord. And certainly don't regret a time I've trusted in His Word. And amen, tonight, thank God. I'm just so thankful tonight that, you know, I can lay down of a night and close my eyes and go off to sleep and Rick don't have to work.
Amen.
Amen. If we don't wake up in this life, thank God, it'll just be all right. Amen.
Amen.
I know, thank God, if I don't, I'll wake up in the presence of the Almighty. Amen. Thank God. And going to a place, amen, for that. There'll be no more suffering. There'll be no more heartaches. There'll be no more pain.
Amen.
I'm looking forward to that day.
Yes,
thank God.
Yes.
Bible said, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, and neither has it entered in to the hearts of man what God has in store for them that love and serve Him.
Yes.
The best is yet to come.
Yes.
Amen. Thank God.
Amen.
I'm longing to see what heaven holds for me.
Yes.
You know, I've always said this. Amen. A lot of people's looking up for the streets of gold, the walls of jasper, and the gates of pearl. Amen. I don't care if it's on a high knob and a laurel thicket. If the Lord is there, I'll be satisfied.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank God. I'm just longing to be with Him.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
For what it bled and died for me. Amen. Thank God. So
yeah.
It's just good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Good to be saved.
Amen.
I'd like to ask everybody to remember our neighbor tonight, Bill Hartle. Amen. I think he went today and he had some surgery done, maybe on cancer. And he's lost, 72 years old. He needs the Lord in his life. And
yeah.
Let's do remember Cheryl and Pauline tonight. Be much of prayer for them. I talked to Cheryl today. I thought he'd be here tonight. But Brother Cheryl's pretty sick too, and Bobby. So let's remember him tonight when we're praying.
Yes.
Pray one for a day. Remember the let's do remember all the unsaved tonight.
Yes.
There's been a lot of names called out. A lot of people called names out here last night. And, amen. We had a wonderful service here last night. Two come was anointed. Amen. And thank God we just had a wonderful time.
Amen.
Amen. I'm a firm believer in one thing. Amen. Just be obedient to the Spirit of God and God will bless you.
Amen.
If you're not obedient to it, then He ought to whoop you. Amen. I'll just be honest with you. Thank God. So let's everybody just dismiss everything that happened today and what might take place tomorrow. Amen. The Lord may come before we leave here.
Amen.
Thank God. Sure. Let's be ready to go. He does.
Amen.
Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Good to be saved. Pray for us. We'll pray for y'all. The best of your life.
Amen. Good testimony. Amen. Anybody? Paul has an unspoken request. We've been known by lifting your hands.
Yes.
Everybody that can and will is gathered here around the altar. Come on,
Father in heaven, it's again, Lord, that we bow once again. Your heavenly Father, this side of me. Lord, we thank you again tonight. You're always for this another heaven bought. Lord, Father, to come this way again. Your Lord, to just heavenly Father, to fall upon bending knees tonight, Lord, and come
from the name of Jesus.
Lord, to thank you tonight, your Lord, for the many blessings of life, your Lord.
Lord, we know that
Heavenly Father is coming to see us tonight, your Lord is
coming. God is coming to
you, Lord, we pray. Heavenly Father, for those tonight, your Lord, that need to heal each other. Lord, that you comfort the hearts of the
fathers tonight, your Lord.
They have lost a loved one. Father, above all, we pray for the unsaved,
your Lord,
we speak to them.
Where else can we go? You have the words of
life. Lord, to an old-fashioned altar. Father, I pray tonight, dear Lord, again.
Prayer right now,
Lord, you speak
your grace.
Father, send conviction, dear Lord, to convict that heart.
Lord, I pray for Brad.
Lord, that you stand for
sin. That you
Heavenly Father, we ask your blessings tonight for each one, for each family. God, grant each blessed, your Lord, to stay home. For each unspoken, your Lord, to every heart. God, you know every need tonight. Father, I pray you supply each one. Lord, according to thy riches and glory. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessings to all those that come tonight. Your Lord, to save the soul of God, to preach your brother.
No weapon formed against us shall prosper. God be for us, who can be against us? Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors.
Lord, above all, tonight, if there's one in our midst, God, they don't know you in a free partnership. And Lord, may this be denied. God, to surrender your heart and life unto thee. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing of the little place of worship. Lord, may it grow and prosper in this old winter station for you. Father, send us an old-fashioned revival. God, you're on the hilltop, your Lord, and we all remember. Father, speak to those up and down the valley tonight, God. Father, send conviction in this community.
Lord, to comfort our hearts, Lord, and to draw near to you, Lord.
Father, again, lead us and guide us.
Lord, if we've got sin in our lives, Lord, that we need to lay down tonight, help us to see that, God. Lord, you call us home to be with them.
Father, we'll never fail to mount some word, give you the praise. Lord, the honor and glory for it all.
I know I fall short every day. Help us, God, in Jesus' name.
Y'all got a call, we can always come on and sing first.
Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Amen. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord.
I'm going to turn it up.
While here on this earth, we move all around, from city to city, up hills and down, over rough roads and highways, across mountains so high, that I'll soon be leaving for my home in the sky.
Amen.
I'm changing houses, I'm moving from here. I've got a new one that's free from all care. One without heartache.
Praise the Lord.
Where we'll never grow old. All by my Savior.
Bless the Lord.
Blood pure as gold.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I'm ready to move.
Yes.
My bags are all packed.
Yes, man.
I'll soon be leaving, and I won't look back.
That's right, Lord.
I made preparations when I called on His name.
Yes, praise the Lord.
He said, you're chosen, and you won't lose again.
Yes, hallelujah.
I'm changing houses, I'm moving from here.
Thank you, Lord.
I've got a new one that's free from all care. One without heartache, where we'll never grow old. All by my Savior, the blood pure as gold.
Hallelujah.
Oh, my new house is grand, the splendor untold, and the mortgage is blood, and it's all been paid for.
Bless her, Lord.
Since my contract was signed,
Hallelujah.
I've got a near one that's free from all care. One without heartache, where we'll never grow old. Bought by my Savior, the blood pure as gold.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Where would I be if he didn't care? Who would I turn to if he wasn't there?
Yeah, bless you.
When my life was almost gone and my soul was crossing over, who would hear my final prayer, if he didn't care?
Yes, that's what he meant.
He didn't mind that he had no place to lay his head. The crown of thorns I should have worn, but he wore it instead.
Bless the Lord.
Yeah. Yes. Amen.
Who would I turn to?
Bless
he wasn't there.
Yes.
Yes.
Sure, Lord.
In my life was almost gone.
Yeah. Bless the Lord.
Amen.
And my soul is crossing over. Who would hear my final prayer if he didn't care?
Amen.
He was there when I needed someone to take my place. He's the one that I think of when I sing Amazing Grace.
Hallelujah.
And he won't delay his coming with this world to meet despair. What would I do? He didn't care.
Amen.
Where would I be if he didn't care?
Amen. Hallelujah.
Should be on now. Just map turn your mic somewhere.
Thank you. Our heads were low, our steps were slow, as they walked along the long maze road. Then a man appeared as he grew near. He said, "Why are you so sad? Things really that bad?" They said, "Sir, have you not heard? You must be a stranger in this town, 'cause the one who came in the Father's name, he has been took down. They laid his body in the ground." As they began to walk, he began to explain why he came. He opened the script and began to speak. The preacher a preacher, he began to preach. In the wilderness, the children had nothing there to eat, but manna from heaven came down at their feet. They were dry and thirsty in a foreign land. Living water came up out of the rocks and sand. Three Hebrew children were thrown in the plain. A fourth man appeared, he was calling by name. The manna, the water, the man are all the same. If you're confused, just let me explain. It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
I'm the one you left back there on Calvary. It was me.
Yeah, bless
you. Who do you think hung the stars in the sky? Who do you think made the day and the night? Who made the flowers? Who made the trees? Who made the sun and the moon and the seas? Who gives life to those who believe? Who do you think made the blind and the king? Who made the very air that you breathe? Who do you think of the victory? It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
It was me.
I'm the one who died for you on Calvary. It was me. Who loved you when no one else would? Who saved you when no one else could? It was me.
I'm glad I served that all powerful God. People like to say the things that he's changed, and he can't do the things he used to do when he walked up on the earth, but I see it every day.
Yeah.
He's not changed, but we have.
Yes. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord.
They ask what I do. Can
Have to worry anymore.
said my last goodbye. I'll see my Savior standing at the door. He'll say, my child, you're welcome. All your cares are left behind. And I won't have to worry anymore. No, I won't have to worry when I reach the other shore. All my troubles will be over, and I'll rest forevermore. My eyes will be on Jesus, and my heart will be aglow. And I won't have to worry anymore. No, I won't have to worry anymore.
Amen.
I'm glad the bridegroom is going to meet the bride.
Yeah. Amen.
someday we'll leave this old world.
Yeah.
Right. Ain't nothing to hold me back here, brother. Right. Ain't got a thing here.
Amen.
That I need or I want.
Amen.
All I want is to go to heaven.
Amen.
Yeah.
And being at home in glory will be right. Peace and joy forevermore.
Yeah. Come on, brother.
A place of love.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Come on, yes. Amen.
Jesus said, I'll go away, but if I go away, I will come again and receive you to myself. That where I am, there you can be also.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Brother, he don't lie.
That's right, brother. Come on.
He doesn't tell us anything that's not so. Hey. So one day we can look toward that eastern sky.
Yeah.
And we can expect our Savior to appear.
That's right. Amen.
Praise God, it's like Brenda was saying. Amen. We'll be there. But when they crowned King of Kings, our brother, he'll guard himself.
Yeah.
And he'll serve us at that fine table.
Yeah.
And we'll get to sit there with the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I tell you, people worried about what the, like the brother said a while ago, the word about walking on the gold, the word about the pearl gates and all this stuff. I know that stuff matters to me. Oh, they worry about a lot of them wanting to see their family, and I know that when we lose our loved ones down here, that we want to be reunited with them. But the biggest thing on my mind and in my heart is, when I want to get there, I want to be able to look and find Jesus first thing.
Yeah.
And just be able to bow down and kiss his feet and tell him how much I love him and appreciate him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Brother, I tell you, it's going to be a good time over there. People don't like noise down here. They think it gets too loud. My brother over there, it's going to be noise all the time.
Amen.
But we're going to be praising the Lamb of God.
Amen.
I'm glad I'm saved tonight.
Amen.
I'm glad I'm heading home.
Yeah.
Leaving this old world of trouble and sorrow behind.
That's right.
Amen.
Hallelujah, man.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm glad I'm saved tonight. I'm glad to be in God's house.
Amen.
We think about a lot about revival, and it always comes to mind Psalms 85:6 says, will thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? And I look for revival each and every day.
It just
don't have to be a called thing. It don't have to be something that a pastor calls at a church. I believe revival is a state of mind and also the state of heart. And
right.
I think that we've got to get in a good state of mind and a good state of heart. Been revival, and like I said last night, sometimes we've got to look at ourselves, we've got to search ourselves, we've got to ask God to search us out and to show us, what things we're doing wrong. There's a lot of times we get a little bit ho-hum in our Christian living sometimes, and we need to, tighten up a little bit. I like to look stuff up in the Webster Dictionary, and under revival it says a renewed attention or interest or something, or a period of renewed religious interest. And that's what revival is. We got to get interested in this thing again. We got to show a little bit of enthusiasm. We got to show a little bit of happiness about us. If people see this with long faces all the time and say it's all moaning and groaning around, no wonder people don't want to go to church anymore. We ought to be a happy people today. We ought to be a people that's glad to be God's people, that know we're saved and we're going to heaven. If nothing else makes you happy, after you think about it, we're going to go to heaven.
Right,
we don't have to face that devil's hell anymore. That we made that decision on this side of life, and I'm glad that on a Tuesday night during a revival that I accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior, and I'm still saved today. I got saved that night, and I'm still saved today.
Amen.
I've not been perfect, but I've been saved the whole time, I strayed away sometimes, but the Lord has called me back in, and I appreciate what the Lord has done here tonight. I know we had a little bit of problem with the musical stuff and all that, but that's all right. The message has gone out. I enjoyed the singing. I enjoy my church family here. I came all the way from Kingsport and to be with us tonight. And I really appreciate that. I love y'all so much. And I love this church here. I feel like I'm just a big part of this family also. And I got several churches I preach at. And I just feel, and if you don't feel that way inside a church, I just really don't want to go back anymore. But for churches I go, I feel at home when I go to them. I feel like I'm one of them. And that's how Christian people ought to be. But we talk about revival. And really, I started studying a little bit, and what the Lord's put in my heart tonight.
kind of, there's stages of revival also. It all begins, we've heard out all of our lives that, you know, revival starts, you make a little circle in the floor and you get in and like, revival starts in you. And that's truly a true saying tonight that, you know, that's where revival starts in each and every one of us. That then it spreads throughout the church. I believe that with all my heart that when one person gets it, it just goes from chest to chest, from person to person, and it grows and grows inside the church. And then when it gets into church and you really truly have revival in your heart, then it spreads to the community. I read a book from Pat Robinson one time, and he talked about revival, and he said, you know, a true revival, you really can't tell what the if you really had a true revival or not until months later, when you see what effect you had on your church and what effect you had on your community around you. Then in community, when it spreads, it's going to go to whosoever. And, well, and that's what we need to do is spread that gospel today. Right, you know, yeah. We've got good news to tell people. You know, we don't have to right. wallow around here in this world. We got a good place to that. I think we're having a good time here. You know, yeah. I know we can't you know even imagine what heaven's going to be like. But you know, we here right now, we can enjoy what the salvation that the Lord has gave us right here, right now, and I appreciate what He does, but that's the four steps to revival, and I believe that God sending revival, you know, when we announced this calling here, you know, I made sure God was in it. Brother Fred came to me and asked me about it, and we prayed and everything. The Lord sent this revival, you know, it's got to be God sent it. It's just like any message or anything else. If it ain't God sent, it's all done in vain. I believe today that, you know, God sent this revival. If not, I would have called Brother Fred tonight and said, Fred, God's just not in this thing. I'm not coming up here tonight, you know, but God's in this thing here, you know, and it's not the number of people. It's not anything like right. that, you know, it's what the people that's here, you know, you can't preach to the person that's out there, you know, right. we got to preach to what's in, and that's the reason I love coming, I love hearing preaching, I love what Brother Johnny said, what Brother Fred said tonight, and, you know, we, as a people, we need to grow, and you know, and want to grow in the word of the Lord, you know, yeah. it says in the Bible, you know, show ourselves a workmanship yeah. of the Lord, and we got to grow in that knowledge, we got to read that Bible, we got to pray, and I prayed a lot, you know, this last couple of weeks since we announced this revival here. I prayed a lot. I was seeking God's face each and every day that, you know, God had me to do what you'd have me to do. You know, yeah. let Earl step out of the way and let you come in and preach these messages. And that's the important things. And yeah. I think someone else already said tonight that, you know, we each got a burden on our hearts. And I guarantee you go around and ask, and each of us has got a problem in our lives. Each of us has got something going on in our lives, sickness or dead or whatever, but or lost person in our family. But praise God, we got somebody that we can go to. We got somebody that we can depend on, and that's Jesus Christ. And I'm grateful for Him that He's always there, you know.
Yep.
I would do my best to help anybody here in this church, but I might let you down, you know, without, you know, not, you know, I may not be able to help you in any way, but, you know, God's always there for us, and we always got a place to go, and we can go to Him tonight, and I love Him with all my heart, but we'll get into the message here, but I appreciate what the Lord has done here at this little church. I appreciate the opportunities that Brother Fred has given me, and how the Lord hooked us up, you know. Brother John asked me, he said, how in the world did you find this place? And I said, well, it just, you know, that Lord worked it out. Brother Fred Braggs, one of our patients down at work, and that's how we got to know each other. And that's how the Lord works. You just never know how He's going to deal with you. But, you know, I enjoy coming up here. I look forward to coming up here. It's a good ride coming up out here. When you were saying that I don't regret a mile, you know, I travel for the Lord, and I don't. We listened to that song coming up here on the way up the mountain, matter of fact, and by the Happy Goodman family, he was singing it there, and I don't regret a mile, and I've enjoyed my trip. You know, yeah. I enjoy my life with the Lord. I enjoy, you know, people talk about, well, it's hard, and at times it is difficult, but it's a joy to, you know, serve the Lord. It's a joy to be around God's people. See, amen. I get blessed when I come to church. I get blessed when I see other people singing the song of Zion. I get blessed when people testify, especially when my wife testifies. It just touches my heart, and, you know, and she's one of the most praying women that I know. I know she's praying for me each and every time that I get up. I know that. You know, I know my church is because they tell me they are. And I can feel those prayers. But I'm thankful for tonight that God is always there for us. I'm thankful that we can turn to Him in times of need, in times of trouble, in times of anything that we can turn to Him. I'm so thankful for Him tonight. But I appreciate each and every one of you. But you got your Bibles tonight. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2. If you're able to stand tonight and stand with me, I'm going to read the first, I think, five verses here. Okay.
2 Timothy chapter 2. Maybe a few notes here. We're, I want to go by a little bit. So, starting in verse number 1 says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Jesus Christ, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Christ.
Yes.
No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him that he hath chosen to be a soldier. And if any man also strive for mastery, yet he is also crowned, except he strive lawfully. The husband that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruits." I'm going to ask my good friend, Brother Vern Hall, to lead us in prayer, please.
Amen. Father in heaven, we come in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we just thank you, dear God, for the reading of this holy word tonight.
Yes,
Lord, I pray you'll take your servant, Brother Earl, this great man of God, and that's what he is, Lord, because he preaches your word, and you're with him, dear God. And just use him mightily for your glory. Lord, I ask God that you'll send the word through Brother Earl that we need in this day and time that we're living in right now. As it's already been stated here, every one of us, we're facing some form of trial or situation in our life. And may we ever seek our guidance from your word, from you, dear God. And we thank you for all that you've done, all that you mean to us, all that you're going to do. Thank you for sending your son to die on the cross that we might have everlasting life. It's in his name, the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Burton. So, tonight I want to talk about three things: the strength, commitment, and endurance.
Listen to Jeffrey.
Romans 5:1-2 says, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into his grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God." And I believe that the strength part, you know, comes from the faith of hearing God's word. You know, the Bible says faith comes by hearing the word of God. We got to have that strength in these times. You know, we got to have the strength today to stand up and teach and preach the word of God. And, and those people that, you know, some people say, "Well, I'm not a teacher or a preacher." Well, if you're a born again believer, then you've got a job to do also. Amen. We've got to go out there and tell the gospel, and we got to have that strength each and every day, especially today. You know, it seems like everything in the world's against the Christian today, and we got to stand strong in Christ. We can't waver. We can't bend. We can't break. We got to stick closely to the word of God. As Brother Rick said, we got to study our Bible. We got to know the word of God. You know, and able to be a help to somebody, we got to know the word of God ourselves. And we got to do that by hearing the word of God. But we got to have that strength. But we're justified. You know, I'm glad we're justified into his grace of where we stand. And we rejoice in that hope that we know that hope that is true hope. It's just not something like I hope I would get a new car, I hope I get a new job. It's a hope that we can depend on. It's a for sure hope that's here today. And I appreciate what God has done for us today. I appreciate that that strength can come from him. You know, I don't have to, you know, get that strength from any other place. You know, that strength comes straight from God. You know, in verse later, Romans chapter 5 says, "But God commendeth his Lord love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You know, if I didn't go any farther tonight, then right there, I'll just make us happy tonight. Amen. You know, you was once a lost man, just like I was. You know, we're born lost in this world. And a lot of one guy on the radio said, you know, at one time that, you know, she said kids was born in love, and kids was born, you know, in innocence and everything. You know, a kid actually was born, you know, they know how to do evil. You got to teach them how to do right, and you got to bring them up right. You know, you don't have to teach a little kid to lie. You got to teach them how to tell the truth. You know, you got to teach them that. And but, you know, we're all born in sin. I was born in sin. You know, they're not at the age of accountability, but once you get at the age of accountability, and I think that's a different age, and that's a lot of different, you know, theories on that and everything. I think it's at different ages. I think somebody that's heard the gospel, now maybe at the age of 7 or 8 or 9 years old, that's the age of accountability. That somebody's maybe not heard the gospel, it may be 14, 15, or 16, or 20. I don't know, you know. But it's when you understand that. But he died for us, and he died for you, and he died for me, that we can have this time of freedom that we just have today. And we got that love that's inside us. You know, when Christ died and his son came inside us, when you're born again,
He lives inside of you. You know, we got to watch where we walk, because every place we walk, we take him with us. You know, I once heard a man say, I can't get away from him. If I wanted to leave God behind, I couldn't. He's right there with us. He knows every move that we make. He follows every step and every place that we go. He's there. But, you know, we got to be bold today. We've got to be bolder than we ever was before. And not mean, but we got to be bold. We've got to tell people the truth. You know, the truth was just going to set people free. It's not the whitewashed down stuff. It's not the, you know, haphazardly stuff, that, you know, the feel-good stuff, particular air stuff. It's the truth of the Word of God. And the truth is that either you've got the blood applied to your heart or you don't. And either the heaven's your home or hell's your home. You know, that's the two destinations that we got. And we make a choice on this side of life. And I pray today that each and every one of you, like I said last night, I don't take it for advantage that everybody in here is saved. I don't know. As far as I know, you are, but only you know what your relationship is with Christ. And if you're not saved, I wouldn't wait till I get through preaching here tonight. I'd come right now, because as I've always been saying here tonight, the Lord could come back before we get leave here tonight. So, you know, we got to have that strength in this time. We got to pray for one another. And forgiveness is a lot about that too. You know, sometimes I may make somebody mad. Sometimes somebody might get on my nerves. But, you know, we got to have forgiveness in our hearts for each and everybody. If I can't forgive you and you can't forgive me, but, you know, how can Christ forgive us? You know, Christ forgave us when we were yet sinners, when we were awful people. Yeah. But he saved our souls, and he went to that cross. He died for each and every one of us. But we got to have that strength, and I'm glad of that strength. Hebrews 4:16 says, "Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in the time of need." And I find myself in that time of need more often these days than I ever have before. I find my time that I need to go pray to him more and more and more each and every day. And I guess that's a good thing, I guess. But, you know, I get worried about the world sometimes. I get worried about my family. I get worried about different situations. And I know the Bible says, "Let not your heart be troubled." But, you know, sometimes, I'll be honest, I get troubled sometimes. I get upset sometimes. I get confused at times. I can't see why five of the smartest men in the United States, the Supreme Court justices, is some that they're the dumbest decision ever was. You know, I would not want to stand in their shoes. I'd be afraid to be in their shoes. You know, that's five of the smartest men that's supposed to be in the United States, and they made that, you know, in history now, that, you know, that same-sex marriage is legal. Well, it's still illegal to me in my mind. It's still illegal in God's Word, and that's what we've got to go on. You know, I thank God for that sin and that revival. You know, I'm glad that we serve a living God. You know, I read after Mays Jackson one time, and he was in a revival, and at the time that Elvis Presley had died, and he said the next day the newspaper read, you know, "The King is dead," and at the revival that night, he says, "Well, I don't know what king they're talking about. The king I serve is still living and going strong today." And that's the King Jesus that I'm talking about. You know, he's still alive today. You know, he's still there, you know. I believe that, you know, in my heart, as I see things, and you can differ with me if you want to, this is just a personal thing, I believe that the United States has went one step too far as turning as a nation back around to the God. But I still believe that revival can come to his people, and I still believe that people's getting saved. I still believe that, and with all my heart, I still believe in revivals, or I wouldn't be up here doing this. I believe that God's people need revival. I believe that we need to stretch out our minds. We need to lift up our voices, and we need to shed some tears. It tickled me to death last night, because everybody in the church house came to the altar last night. Yeah. Everybody, you know, even the kids came to the. It was a blessing to me to look around, Brother Fred, and see that. You know, that's what we need more of. It's a church that prays together, church that stays together. I believe that with all my heart. I believe in family prayer. I believe in praying for each other. I believe in lifting up your name to God. You know, each of us, and we need that. I need that today. But we've got to have that strength in God, and know that that strength does come from God, and he'll give us the strength to do that. You know, I've said many, many times in the pulpit that I argued with God for 14 months about announcing my calling to preach. I didn't want to do it. I think I'm just thinking that because my daddy was a preacher. I you know, everybody told me all my life, "Are you going to be a preacher? You're going to be this?" And I struggled with that. I didn't want to. I think I don't want to be nothing that God doesn't want me to be. That when I was standing out, now this is my testimony, when I was standing out in the ocean with my youngest son Jason, and how the sand goes out underneath your feet, where the sand wasn't moving anymore. You know, we was out there in the evening, and the sand, it was just like standing on concrete. It wasn't moving anymore. And it just felt like the Lord talking to me out there. He said, Son, I know you can't preach, but I'm going to be preaching through you. And that's when I accepted my calling to preach on that Wednesday night. You know, God let us know that it's Him doing the work. You know, I can't save anybody here tonight. I can't do anything for other than preach the gospel to you. And unless the Holy Spirit comes to somebody, you know, it don't do no good anyway. It was said last night, you know, when I go to church a lot of times when I was younger, they come back and jerk your arm out of socket to pull you up. And I don't know if they had a quota to make it, how many people got an altar or not, but, you know, that's a bad thing. And but I finally learned, you know, I wasn't a dummy. I was kind of a straight person. I wasn't a dummy. And they come back and say, are you saved? And I was. And they come back and say, are you saved? I say, yeah. And so they just leave me alone. And I learned that. And but that one Tuesday night, though, when I went to church, you know, the Lord came and dealt with me. Nobody had to come and get me. Nobody had to drag me up there. Nobody had to, you know, jerk my shoulder out of socket. The Holy Spirit moved me. And if the Holy Spirit moved you tonight, that's when you should move right then. And that's what you should do. But I don't believe in going back there unless the Lord's telling you to go back and talk to somebody. If the Lord's telling you, that's a different story. And, you know, we a lot request for prayer for our two boys. And one of the things that happened to them in church, but they was at a young age, and they went, and it's just a story that, you know, we got to guard our churches. You know, pastors has got a lot to be responsible for. You know, everything's come out of this pulpit. Brother Fred here's got to be responsible for everything's preached for. Brother Vern's, he's responsible for everything comes out of that church there. So we got to be responsible. They was at this church one night, and these ladies came back and said, you know, you want to go to the altar? They said no, and they said, well, we give you $100 a piece, come up to the altar. And ever since, they snuck out and went in the car. But, you know, that just turned her, and that's something that just turns you sour against people. You know, I got upset when I heard that. I could wring their necks, you know. That's been a stumbling block to people. That's really hurting people. But we got to have that strength to die. We got to make sure that we know that we're going to go straight on and toward that prize, that high calling, what God's got set for us. And I know that, you know, one of these days that, you know, it's appointed man wants to die. One of these days that somebody's going to be standing up above me if the Lord don't come back and preach it. And like I said many times, I want to push my body out of the way and just preach a sermon. I want to go to church that day. But we got to have that strength. I pray for strength for the church. I pray for strength for the individuals tonight. But the second thing's commitment. You know, we got to have a commitment to serve God most of all. We got to have a commitment to do that. You know, and we got to have a commitment to come to church. You know, we got to have a commitment to, you know, do what God, you know, when God told us over in Hebrews to go to church, you know, assemble ourselves together, He didn't put a question if you wanted to or anything. He told us to assemble ourselves together. So we're required to be at God's house whenever we can. And I know there's sickness that happens. There's work that happens. There's things that comes up. And there's reasons for people. But if you can be at God's house, you need to be at God's house. And I believe that with all my heart. But people don't want to make a commitment. People don't want to, you know, have that commitment. It seems like even, I talked about marriage earlier. It seems like marriage is a commitment. They get married one day, and next month they want to get a divorce. But it's a commitment thing, you know. Man, my wife's been married for over 39 years now, and you know it's a commitment that we've made. And you commit, make that commitment in front of God, and that's a very, very serious thing. But I think marriage is a very sacred institute. But I'm gonna read a little bit out of Psalms 37. I'm gonna read verses 1-5, and it says, "Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good, so that thou would dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give them the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, also trust in Him, He shall bring it to pass. So that's three words: is trust, delight, and commit. And that first thing, we got to commit to Him, and He's going to see that if we get, you know, I believe that God's going to see all of our needs today. You know, I believe that if we commit to doing the God's way, that He's going to see that our lives, you know, that we get through our lives, that He's going to bless our lives. You know, He's blessed us beyond compare. You know, we're not rich by no means, but we've got everything that we need. We got a modest house, we got a good car, you know, and all that, and got a decent job. So also, you know, he has blessed us. You know, I look at what I used to be, how we used to struggle so much financially, and growing up through the years, how God has blessed me. And a lot of times, you know, we've got to get older and look back on our lives and see how God's intervened there and how he's stepped in and he's made things right and how he's stepped in and he's led people to you. I've had so many blessings during my life. I can look back. I didn't appreciate it then. I can look back now and look at the people that God's put in my life, and I really appreciate them, those people now. But we got to have a commitment, and then thirdly, we got to have endurance. We got, you know, there's this race that we're running here. We got to have endurance. We can't throw our hands up and say, no, I'm not going to do this thing anymore. I'm just tired of it. My body's aching. I'm tired. It seems like nothing's getting accomplished. It seems like nobody's paying attention and all this. You know, we got to have that endurance that God's going to give us. That, you know, one of these days that each of us, you and me too, we're going to face Jesus Christ at the judgment seat of Christ, and it's going to be judged on the works that we do, whether they be good or bad. And I'll be honest with you, I'm not looking forward to that day. I know that, you know, we're not going to be judged on our salvation, but we're going to be judged on our works. And there's a lot of times Earl slacked off. There's been a lot of times that, you know, Earl's backed away a little bit. You know, said, well, I'll let somebody else go ahead and do that. I'll let somebody else take care of that. You know, when we should be the ones to step up. You know, anytime there's a job in the church, anytime there's something needs to be done, they ought to be people knocking the door down inside the church wanting to get it done. And that's what God's people needs to do. We need to be busy about the Lord's business here tonight. You know, we need to be busy about it. We need to, you know, we need to think about what he's done in our lives. I know he's blessed you, and I know that he's blessed me, so we need to tell him we appreciate him. You know, he knows our hearts. He knows what I'm trying to, a lot of times I spit and stutter when I'm up here, but I got a thousand things going through my mind, and Teresa told me 100 times, she said, you know, if you slow down preaching, you can preach for an hour, but you know, I can't slow down. That's just how the Lord gives to me. I got to give it, but it don't matter if it's 5 minutes or an hour and 5 minutes is what the Lord gives us. But I believe tonight that we've got to have that strength, and we've got to have that commitment, and we've got to have that endurance, and it all comes from the Lord. And you know, he's been good to me. I think he's been better to me than anybody here in this building tonight. I believe that, and I'm sure that you probably can say the same thing. You know, I'm so blessed to have this many people that, you know, that loves me, that prays for me, and I just go on and on about the stuff that the Lord does for me. But you know, I think through revival, the main thing that we got to look at is are we really serving him how he wants us to serve him? You know, are we really doing the things that we need to be doing? You know, a lot of people want to, you know, and this may not be an easy hallelujah message or anything, but you know, a lot of people want to sit back on their pews and do absolutely nothing once they get saved. But you know, the Lord wants us to do something. You know, the biggest thing that we can do inside the church is pray. You know, that's the biggest thing. You know, and when I say that, you don't have to physically be doing that, but that we can be prayer warriors. That's the most important thing inside the church or any place that has a bunch of prayer warriors praying for you. I can tell when people are praying for you. Now, and I'll be honest with you, you can pray when people's praying against you too. Yeah. And there's a spirit that comes up, and I preach at places where, you know, I just really felt like, well, I wish they'd let, you know, I would shut up and sit down. But, you know, we've got to go on with the Lord's message. But, you know, Lord's been too good to me to ever quit him. And even though I may not be the best preacher, don't ever claim to be that, but, you know, I do claim to be one of his children. I'm a child of God, and I believe tonight that, you know, if you're one of his, that you'll want to do better. And regardless of age, it don't matter if you're 16 or 86, you know, we need to get a little bit closer walk with God. You know, we need to get closer. We need to know that he's there. We need to show this world out here that, you know, there is a difference between a real blood-bought Christian than these so-called, you know, whitewashed Christians, I guess you could say. You know, I'm going to stand up. You know, a lot of people say, I don't like going to church because I don't want to hear the negative, you know, negative stuff. I don't want to be told what to do. Well, the Bible tells us what to do. And it don't matter what Earl says or don't matter what Brother Fred says, but it's what the Bible says. And I don't want to get on the big thing about homosexuality, but yeah, it's a big deal to me. We got friends, we got neighbors, and that's, you know, the homosexual lifestyle and everything. I love them with all my heart. I want to see that. I want to see them change. You know, I don't want to see them in that condition if the Lord comes back and calls his church home. You know, they're going to go through some terrible times here. But I want to see them saved. And I'd like to see a whole group of same-sex people come in here and get saved here tonight. I still believe that the Lord can reach out and touch them and save them. You know, I was lost in sin also, you know, but I believe they can get saved. So we've got to pray for that. But also, at the same time, we got got to stand up in the pulpit and say, it's wrong. You know, it's not what the Word of God says. It's totally wrong. And I get off on those two subjects sometimes. And, you know, I know one lady, I'm not going to mention names, she's had an abortion. Her daughter's 17-year-old's already had an abortion. You know, I don't understand that. You know, I don't understand how you can take a life of a baby. I heard a preacher the other night that said there'd been 60 million babies aborted since the Roe Wade thing went into effect back in 1970, what it was. Our 60 million little babies has been aborted. You know, that's a shame. You know, why ain't Christians standing up and hollering about that? You know, why ain't we raised our voices any place? Why ain't we standing on the street corners? You know, why ain't we here in the streets rioting? You know, why ain't we doing that? Because we want to be so self-induced or whatever that we want to sit in the churches and we want to be quiet about everything. We want everybody to lie. Us and we want to be so well loved, but we're not willing to get out here and put the, you know, Christ's name out there where we ought to be doing. We ought to be strong in Christ. We're going to have to get that strength, and we're going to have to stand up against some things, and it's going to make some people mad. You know, it's going to make a lot of people mad, but that's okay. It's the truth. My mentor, I guess, Orville Rogers, told me when I got ordained that night, he told me, he says, you know, if you preach the word to people and tell people the truth, there's going to be people that hate your guts. There's going to be people mad at you. He said, if they ever get saved, they'll love your man, and they'll love you to death. They'll just hug you. But you know, and that's what we're required to do as preachers and teachers and children of God, is tell people the truth. You know, there is a truth that there is a heaven, and I'm looking forward to going there. But there's a terrible hell too that people's going to have. The Bible says hell's enlarging each and every day, and I don't want to see my loved ones go there. I don't want to see my friends go there. But people's going there each and every day, and it's our responsibility to tell people about Christ. Like I said, we can't get nobody saved, but we can tell people about Christ and plant that little seed in there and tell people, and that you know, somebody else will come along and water a little bit, and eventually God will give the increase, and the increase has got to come from God. But I pray tonight that, you know, we're doing what we're supposed to do. You know, if you really want revival, it's got to start right here in your heart. It's got to start within us. And I believe tonight that, you know, we do here at Cox Chapel. We want revival. We want the Word of God to go out. And I appreciate the men that I've heard preach from this very pulpit here that is truly true men of God. I appreciate my brothers back there, Brother Vern, Brother Johnny, that they're true preachers that preach the Word of God. And Johnny just announced his calling not too long ago, but he's been preaching for a long time before that, but he just announced his calling here a little bit ago. But I appreciate him. I appreciate people that stands up for the Word of God and that's willing to come out. Now, I appreciate my church, but I love each and every one of you so much, but I'm going to come to a close, and I think tonight, you know, and like I said, I know it's probably not a hallelujah message, but we need to get that strength, and we need to get that endurance, and we need to have that commitment to the Lord tonight. You know, we commit to a lot of things, but we got to commit to God the first of all, above all. And once we commit to Him, everything else is going to fall in place. And I believe that with all my heart. I believe tonight that maybe somebody here needs to make that little bit of commitment. Maybe somebody here, maybe a little bit away or whatever, or maybe you just need to come and thank Him. As I said last night, you know, come to the altar. Don't show the sign that you've done anything wrong. Coming to the altar, don't show that you're out of fellowship. Coming to the altar don't mean that you're unsaved or anything like that, but it means that you want to talk to, you know, do some business with God. And that's what the altar's for. And like I said last night, I believe with all my heart that a church that prays together stays together. I love it. And if you feel like coming to the altar, you come to the altar. And I'm not, like I said, I'm not trying to talk you into it or shame you into anything like that. But if you feel like it, you come ahead, and I'll come and pray the best I can with you. I love each and every one of you. And not too long of a message. That's what the Lord laid on my heart. And hope it helps somebody here tonight. God bless y'all. Amen. Brother Fred. Amen.
If I survey all the goodness God's to me from above, and could I count all the blessings out of the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor and beyond mortal ken. And I'm sure He would grant it again.
God to have
I want to stroll over heaven with the church. When all her troubles and heartaches have truth, please hang. The way we'll enjoy all the beauties we're all paid to. I want to stroll over heaven's wings. Will be you on the plain with the friends we meet, and there will be all her loved ones and the saints is true. That will be a glad reunion, and there'll be much while I stroll over her heavenly wings. I want to stroll over heaven with Jesus, when all her troubles and heartaches are truly banned. Oh, we will enjoy all the beauties we're all thanks
for.
I want to stroll for heaven's
God, I just pray, Lord, you'd always use me, Lord, in a mighty way.
When her work here is in, and her life here is through, when I'm called home to glory, I would like God, to see there, you. There we'll sit down by the river with the prince we once knew. While I stroll over heaven with you, I want to stroll over heaven with you someday, when all her troubles and heartaches have truly vanished away. We'll enjoy all the beauties we're all playing. I want to stroll for heaven with
you.
Amen. That's your heart's desire. Amen. That one day after a while that we can stroll over heaven with one another.
Amen.
You know, there's nothing to keep us from. Amen. We want to go to heaven. We can go. Amen. I've always said this. There's not enough of devils in hell that can keep us out of heaven if we try to go to heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Earl was talking about commitments and all of that. You know, I'm a firm believer in one thing. I believe you've got to get on a dose of Holy Ghost salvation. Amen. You've got a desire and a determination. Amen. To be found in the house of God. Amen.
Amen.
I believe you got a determination to make heaven your home.
Amen. Right. Amen.
This life is over, but you know, I believe, thank God, that, amen, that you've got to endure to the end. Amen.
Yeah.
To make it all the way.
Yeah.
Bible said, he that endure to the end, the same shall be saved. Amen. So we got to endure this thing to the end. Amen. Not there yet, but well on the way.
Amen.
Amen. So. But children, tonight, there's no five. I've always said this, a quitter never wins and a winner never quits. Amen. Yes. To obtain the prize and the reward at the end of life's journey. Amen. We're going to have to finish the race that's set before us. Thank God. And
amen.
I'll tell you, it'll be worth it all when we come down to the end of life's way. Just to hear him say, well done, enter into the joys of the Lord. That'll be worth it all. Thank
amen.
God.
Amen.
Amen. Every mile you've traveled for the Lord, every storm you've withered, thank God,
yeah.
It'll be worth it all. And
yes.
I've always said this, amen, a good soldier, amen, he'll fight a lot of battles in life, and you'll wind up with a lot of battle scars along the way.
Yeah.
Amen. But there's one thing about it. Thank God it'll be worth it to the end. Amen.
Amen.
Come down to the end of life's journey. Amen. So it's just good tonight to have each one of you with us. And tomorrow night, I believe Brother Earl said that Lights of Christ will be with us. And whoever else, amen. So everybody remember that. And I'd like to say again tonight, appreciate you all coming and being with us. And come back anytime you can and be with us, amen. And if you can't come, be much in prayer, amen. And just do pray one for another. And worship God, amen, and spirit and the truth. And amen. I've always said this, amen, there's no big eyes and little U's. Amen, in the family of God, we're all striving for the same country.
Yeah.
Amen. If you're saved tonight, we all got saved the same way. Amen. Through it by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So
amen.
I'm longing to make heaven my home. Amen.
Yes.
And
amen.
I hope and pray you are. And I let me say tonight, don't give up. Don't get discouraged. Amen. Somebody said the church is going down. No, the church is going up.
Right. Amen. Amen.
It's going up. Amen.
Yeah.
And I just want to be part of it, don't
amen.
You?
Amen.
Amen. Thank God. So tonight, amen. Has anybody got anything in your heart or mind before we come to dismissal tonight? Amen. If not, let's everybody stand. We'll sing a revival song and we'll take a right hand of fellowship and we'll dismiss you in the fear of the Lord. Lord, send a revival. Lord, send a revival. Lord, send a revival and let it begin with me. Shout along, pray along, prayer changes things. Amen.
Amen.
Love you all, good night, and God bless you.
Yes, well, friend, I love you.
Appreciate you.